Welcome back to another episode of Nerd Perspective, where I, Tony from Nerd Gallery, sit down with friends all over the world to talk and to learn new perspectives around Indonesian textile art. And today, we'll be talking to Dewa from Museum Batik in Pekalongan, where we will learn all about behind the scenes in running a museum about batik in the center of batik in Indonesia. And without further ado, sit back, relax, and enjoy Dewa's Nerd Perspective.
Okay. Yes, welcome Mas Dewa to another episode of Nerd Perspective. How are you doing in Pekalongan?
Yes, fine, thank you. How about you, Tony?
Good, I'm good. Yes, so we met, the last time we met was way back in 2019. So if we see his Instagram, he is a photographer, a musician, and a lot of like creatives. But I knew him through our visits to Pekalongan, and he is one of the staff in the Museum Batik Pekalongan. And today we'll be talking more about his role in the museum and how is the museum is surviving the pandemic and the programs that he has. So welcome Mas Dewa again, and probably we can start with a little introduction about yourself and yeah, how you landed up in Museum Batik.
Yes. Okay, Tony, thank you for this opportunity. Okay, I'd like to introduce myself. My name is, my full name is Pasar Timur Fajar Dewa. You can call me Fajar or Dewa here. And I'm working in this museum since 2014 as a guide. And I became a guide, museum guide for 5 years. And in 2019, my job until now, my job now as a program planner and a public relations here. And so my job here is to create some plans, programs, and associated with the society, how to improve the museum, how to conserve the batik culture here. That's my programs now. And yes, my educational background is on literature, and also, you know that I also love another kind of art like movie, music, visual art, and photography. That helps me to get close to the batik cultures, which when the first time I came to the museum, I really know nothing about batiks. Even I wore the printed batiks, came here, I still remember that the design is the parang rusak, but printed, fake batik. And my boss told me, you use fake batiks, we have original batiks here, buy one, buy two, and you must wear when you work here in the museum. And yes. That's the first time I get close to batik and try to learn about batiks there. Okay.
Are you a native Pekalongan? Or?
No, I'm from Palembang.
Oh, okay.
South Sumatra, yes. My wife is a Pekalonganese, okay. And I move here following my wife and get work in the museum. I'm a civil servant. I started my jobs in Palembang there. Then I moved here, and the government picked museum as my place here.
I see. So, kind of like fate brought you into the museum and to learn about batik.
Yes, and my first job as a guide here. I know nothing about batik. And they asked me to be a guide here in the museums, but yes, there is a library here. I'm a literature student. I love to read. Yes, so many reference book as a reference to learn batiks. And my biggest approach to close to batik culture is yes from the art. I love photography, and I like to go to anywhere to take. Capture to take pictures, and especially at the first movement is about batik. I go to the batik artisans, batik workshops. There, I take photographs, and my photography is also I love cultural photography. So I go to the workshops. I meet so many people, so many processing in making batik. I learn from there, and I also love visual art. You know, the paintings, the design graphics. Yeah. So the most easy way to learn batik is by seeing the batik for the first time. The impression is on the visuals. I know the composition, the colors, what image, the symbols, what the symbols refers to. Yes, that's all. That really helps me to learn batik.
Yeah, probably a very good advice to someone who just learned about batik, right? Is to look at
what step is it?
Yeah. How do you find that learning process? How long do you take to learn before you become the guide?
The process, yes, until now I'm still processing.
Of course, yes.
Because you're always learning. So many knowledge must be learned in batik, yes. And I, on the first years, I focus on the knowledge about the batik history, what kind of designs, and what kind of batik styles, and how to use sarung, how to use long cloth, just like that, the basics. And then I move to the society. How batik relates with another elements is like society, the cultures, and the tools. How to use the tools, just like that, etc. The first year is yes, that's my learning time.
Is there a batik in Palembang? From where?
Yes, because I know from the museum. Because in Palembang, mostly hand woven, yeah, songket and etc. Yes, and I see that there is a Palembang batik here in museums. The designs almost the same with the songket, like that. They imitate the just like cilamprang, imitate the source, and then the application is on batik techniques, just like that. Mm-hmm. So that. And because I am from Palembang and. One of my job is to create a concept and pick collections for the exhibitions. I often choose the batik Palembang because when I see it, it's just like I feel like home.
We move on to the museum a little bit. If you can share about the structure of the museum and, as you said, like how you curate pieces. If you can share a little bit more about that.
Okay, yes. So this Museum Batik, we have the name here Museum Batik, not Museum Batik Pekalongan actually. Because at first, the museum started to operate in July 2006. Yeah? And it was a national museum, Museum Batik, that will exhibit that the focus is on the batiks in Indonesia, about Indonesian batiks. And the museum was started by the community. Yes, the community is the key here. And we have community, batik community from Jakarta, and we have batik community in Pekalongan. They collaborated and created this museum like that. And then the museums operated under one of the name is Kadin, Kamar Dagang Industri, yes, operates the fund from Jakarta, yes, and then the Kadin collapse, and then the government, Pekalongan government, took over the museum there. So now the museum is a governmental museum under the Pekalongan government, but still our focus is on national batik, not only Pekalongan batik, just like that. And here's we renewed the structure, the organizations. In the past, we have nothing to with the just such as a curator, just as such as a conservator. But now, in the structure, we have that. We have the curators, structures, preparators, registers, and anything that required in a museum, it's like that. But the problem is we don't have the persons in charge here, because we have about 20 staff here, but only one has educational background as the museology. I myself only in the literature, so I become guide, yeah, educator. And there's no one has a curatorial background, just like the conservator. Once we have a conservator persons here, with the archaeology subjects there from UGM, but now she moved to another department, become a bendahara, treasurer. Oh, yeah.
A treasurer, yeah.
Yes, that's one of the weakness when your operations under the government. There is a hierarchy step for your career there, that someone must move here and there to get the promotions, just like that. So we lost. We lost that person. It's like that.
I see. Interestingly, so it is not actually started by the government. It's actually like initiatives of the community, and then it was under the Chamber of Commerce.
Yes.
When was it?
It is around, I forget the years. It is around 2009, I think. It's like that, that year. Yes, but now our movement is to get back the community. Yes, mm-hmm. We have problems. Since the shifting, we have problems that the community leave us. Yes. Mm-hmm. Because, yes, you know that the sometimes the society has a bad insight about the government, but now we try to gather them again. Because, the development of the museums now, the mentee is the community. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it's really a community base, and how, as your role as a program planner, what are the programs that you organize?
Yeah, so many activities here I have held. Yes, I created some annual programs here, just like batik competitions for several educational levels, starting from the kindergarten until the senior high schools, and also batik competition for the public. And also we have vlog competitions. Mm-hmm. And we also have a program named Learning with the Community, Creative Community. We cooperate with the youth creative community. They to teach the people about anything about. And in 2020, we teach people about painting batiks, and then shibori, and eco prints, and also typography art, doodle art, and photography, yeah, like that. Yes, and in 2020, the public interest is really big. The participants can reach around 500 persons here.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
You know that it was the pandemic era. but we can have the participants like that.
All in on site at the museum.
Some online and okay. Some in the museums, but we still do a tight health protocols here. Oh yeah, for example, we created the batik competitions. Mm-hmm. For students and public here. We have new strategy, because that's annual activities. In non-pandemic era, we held the activity in front of the museums. So the students here will make batik from the empty cloth until it becomes batik for one day, starting from starting at 8 o'clock until 3 p.m. Yeah, all that matter. But now we ask them to create it in home.
Okay.
So they come to the museum to do the registrations and get the materials, and they create the batik in home with the video. They have to document it in the video. And also we move. At first, they have to create it full batiks until the coloring process, until the lorot process. But now we only ngelowongi, only putting wax on the
outlines, yes.
Like that. Yeah, the outlines, yes.
But and those are for
for students, for the public also. And we have the projects, the shifting from making a full batik and only the outlines, we move the targets there for the public's category. If you created the full batiks, the participants will be the owner of the batik workshop. The owner, because the owner will orchestrating all the process there. But when you have to create the only the outlines, the participants is the batik makers. The batik maker is love. So yes, the old woman come here, they do the registration, they make batik. We love that. And what made us happy in 2020, the winner from the public category is the senior high school students who already graduated at 8 years. And she had a really, really great skill in making batik, and we love that the already graduated students win the competitions and make the seniors to fight the seniors like that. We have new bibit in batik.
New seats.
It's like that.
Okay. Also, the competition is not just students and enthusiasts, but also like the artisans, the batik maker themselves also join in and participate.
Yes.
Cool. Nice.
Different category. We have a category for kindergartens. Kindergartens only for coloring batiks.
Okay.
And the elementary and senior high schools, just like the public category, the outline.
Yeah. Oh, I was thinking like kindergarten doing waxing is. I'm like wondering either Pekalongan is a very advanced or because I was told like in some places they can hold a chanting as young as 4 years old or something.
Yeah. Oh yeah. At first, when we wanted to do the competition, we were very afraid because of the pandemic.
Yeah.
The pandemic. We afraid that the school rejected. Because the school itself cannot do activities, and we offer the activities, we operate that they reject it. But the reality, they really have a big interest in it, because yes, they bored with the conditions, and they also don't know how to what subjects to teach in online, just like that. So when we came to them, and they yes like that. They love it.
I think one of the mission or the function of the museum is as the facility for education of continuation Batik education. Do you guys work with the Batik University or like the schools in terms of teaching it as a regular subject?
Yes, we cooperated with the educational institutions there, especially for the for the elementary schools like that. In Pekalongan, we have MULOK, Muatan Lokal. That is the schools must teach Batik, especially for the elementary students, and then they will do the practice in the museum just like that. And in a year, in 1 month, we have to serve around 3,000 students in the museums in a month to practice batiks. So one day we have to serve around 100 students from three schools to create batik from 8 a.m. until 12 o'clock, like that, and in a month. But in 2020, the program start only a week, and then the pandemic. We have to lock down there, stop there after that. And besides that, we also have museum goes to schools.
Mm-hmm.
Museum goes to school. We go to the schools. We teach them about batiks. We brought the materials. We brought they can make batiks in that program. And yes, but now it's over because of pandemic. And we also have cooperations with the university here. We have what we call as program magang for the university to learn something in the museums. And in 2018, we created one of international seminars about batik. The theme is about a decade of Indonesian batik as the international heritage, just like that. And the speaker was Maria Friends. And we cooperated with the UNIKA, Universitas of Pekalongan, where there is one of the batik persons, really important batik persons named Mr. Jahir there. We cooperated with them there. And at that seminar, the Maria Friends talk about how Indonesian's batik influence the other countries now. In the history, we see that in the reference, that in the books, that Indonesian batik is influenced by the other countries, just like India and China. But now the shift. Indonesian is the influence the other country in making batik, just like that.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Is a one-time off event, is it?
Yes, it is in 2019. Yes, one decade of Indonesian batik as international heritage, like that. But the events, the major events, is annual. It is on the National Batik Days. National Batik Days. It is starting in the 2018 actually, where we gather the community to do the activities there. I still remember that in 2018, when the government preparing for the Batik Days, but not really good, and they created a Batik Weeks in. They plan to create a Batik Weeks in around 20 October. And the Batik Days is on 2nd October. We afraid that what happens in the 2nd October, the Batik Days, there is nothing. There is no activities. There will be no effective activities. So
on the important day itself, there is nothing.
So we started gather the community. The community is from the Batik community itself. The businessmen and then the creative youth movement like that. So we gather and we preparing the celebrations of the National Batik Days only three weeks. And then we have plan, we have big plan, and then we go to the governments. We have big plans like this. And then the government support us. And they love the idea. We must have a big celebration in the 2nd October. And at that time, we created the activities like there. We gather around 1,000 people wearing batik sarungs because the government has the movement in batik sarung, using batik sarung. Yeah. And we do the flag ceremonials in front of the museum, and then we do senam, gymnastics, just like that, using batik sarungs. Oh. And then soccer with the batik sarungs.
Oh, okay, cool.
And batik competitions, and we go to the batik village with the majors. I think that's the starting point. That was the starting point, and then continued in the 2019. And in the 2019, we have the special guest Sabin. Sabin Bok, I came here. Sabin Bok came here, and I think we can use you. We can use you as star here. So yes, we created. We add one program there. Making batik with the foreigner, just like that. So we are Sabin, and we also has a volunteer from. We have a volunteer from the student from foreign, mixed with them, and then we make batik. We have what we call as 0 kilometers monument here. Yeah. That is the symbolic. Sabin choose that because it is a symbolic in the Dutch area here.
It's just right outside of the museum. Am I right?
Yes, mm-hmm. The museum. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I believe you don't have that last year.
Yes, in 2020 we do not. We only have batik competition, the vlog competitions, and learning with community. We don't have. We didn't have a big projects with the community at that years. Mm-hmm. Maybe until now, we don't have plan now for. Creating a big movement like that.
And how is the visitorship affected by the pandemic?
Yeah. Okay. The visitors since the pandemic. Before the pandemic, we have around 29,000 more visitors here, but in 2020 we only have 8,000.
Oh wow.
It's hard, very confused in how developing the museums now. We have to promote the museums, but we forbid them to come here. It's like that. And the museum itself, we have tight protocols. Yes, regular protocol, you have to wash hands, we have the hand sanitizer, use masker, and then the thermoguns, like that. And we also have a strategy when there are we limit the guests only for 30% here, and we divide them into 3 groups, 10 for each, and then we guide them. And each room, we only have 3 rooms there, so we divide them into three small groups. Like
I see.
Okay. And yes, kind of like that.
So for the listeners who are not familiar, so they have like 3 rooms, 3 exhibition rooms.
Yeah.
So normally it goes to the main room just after the receptions of the overall Indonesian batik. Sorry. Yeah, am I right? With all the tools and the materials and stuff. And then you move to 2nd room, which is the batik Indonesia from all over Indonesia. And then the last room is the thematic exhibitions.
Yes.
Pekalongan. So, I'm sorry.
The thematic now is about Pekalongan.
Oh, okay.
Pekalongan batik, yes.
Oh, okay. We have not talked about the exhibitions, the exhibits actually. Can you share more about that?
Yes. My job was also to create a concept about the exhibitions. We do the collection rotations every year in the 2nd October in the Batik National Batik Days. every year we change the collection and also the theme, right? And I did the concepts based on our weakness. We have so many batiks here, as the collection is about 1,200 piece, but we don't really have a legendary batiks, just like Danar Hadi. It's like Danar Hadi has a very, very good collection as well. The legendary names comes here. We don't have, even Oi Sucun, we don't have.
Oh. Yeah.
So how to
create to it for 5 years.
How to create the good exhibitions is by story, I think. So by looking for our positions, comparing to the other museums, and also we looking at our collections here, we must do the story here. So the story also based on the situation. Just like here now we have pandemic, so we created the pandemic theme, and we create one of batik icon with the corona blah, blah, blah. And then there's a batik workshop on the center, just like that. And the theme is about rise up batik Indonesia, just like that. And the story, we share the collections from several eras, and we want to show that each era has problem. In the kingdom era, we have problem about batik, but there is a kind of good movement in batik in held by the kingdom era, like that. In the colonials, you know how the pressures from the Dutch, from the Japanese, but there is new batik here in Pekalongan, Buketan, just like Pagi Sore, Jawa Hokokai style. And in 1998, economical goes down here.
The crisis. Yeah.
The crisis, there's how people has a strategy to overcome the problems there. That's like that's we create like that, the story like that. Mm-hmm.
So that's the one that's currently ongoing.
Yes, until now. Mm-hmm. I don't know what next. I don't know what next.
Still, oh, okay.
Yes, we want to give a spirit for the batik maker. Rise up. There's so many problems. It's okay. I often go to the batik makers talking about them in this pandemic era, and yes, so many sad story. Yes, we cannot sell anymore like that. But they have strategy because in Pekalongan itself, there is one product that grow up, the nightgown dusters.
Mm-hmm.
Duster.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So many people now created the nightgown like that. That also sarung.
At home.
sarung because the government's movements wear sarung now. So many demands in sarung grow up. But the negative is also the rise of the printed batiks. You know, the ability people to buy, and now they cannot buy expensive things now, so they try to find the cheapest batiks, and they move to printed batik. Oh, I hate that.
Yeah. Can I ask you about the recent case on the red flood in Pekalongan?
The drop.
Sorry?
What case?
The red flood. So there was this flooding, and then there was like red colors, and they were like blaming the batik industry. So I was like, yes, thinking, is it like the batik or like printed batik? So I don't know if you have any insights.
Yes, so many opinions about that. I see in the batik artists, they also have a collapse opinions about that.
Yeah.
some agree, some protest that it is actually the printed batik colors like that. But also some say yes, we have to fix our systems, go to the to see the environments like that. Yes, but actually that's some say that's the printed batik, but some say that's the indigo soul, the Prussian the batik color. I don't really know what's the truth.
So at this moment, nobody knows what exactly.
Yes, but the biggest problem is not only the plot at the time, but also the rock, the land absorption. The Pekalongan now get down in, under the sea, some of the area. Okay. And one of the area called Pasir Sari is one of the batik area there. And the impact is on the funds also. The museum, the government has to refocusing the funds for the museums like that, for fixing the rock. And now the pandemic, they have to refocusing again. So our fund is getting low.
Yeah. I see. So yes, so coming back to the visitorship, so there's like no visitors and now funding is reduced. So yeah, how is the next strategy for the museum?
Next strategy, yes.
Probably on your program side, what are you working on?
From the starting of this 20 and 21 now, I have nothing to do because I think we have to develop the museums. We have so many internal weakness here, especially for the attention from the government itself, from the tourism departments. We have to get a new strategy so they see the museums as one of the important place. Not only place, but point for developing everything here. Because Pekalongan, the big potential is the batik itself. Now the government is really busy with the pandemic, with the rob, with the burn markets here. And
I'm sorry.
We have the fire. Big markets here. Burn. Yeah.
Okay.
No, we lost one of the big markets. Yeah.
Which market is it?
The name is Banjarsari.
Oh.
So many money goes to them. Yeah. The boats that matters, and it seems that people forget about the museums, the developments. I really want to fix that, created a new system internally also. In museum itself now, because of the pandemic, we have low spirits, no guests. Every day we have to serve guests. The visitors is very, 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 very. We love that. We love that job.
Yeah.
But now no visitors. It seems like what to do? We lost spirits. I really want to get the spirits rise up again. Like that.
What are the different functions that you mentioned earlier? In the museum.
Yes, actually the functions of the museum is to guard, to conserve, and to expose it to the society and give knowledge to the society. We still do that basic function of the museums. We have a museology here, which he did everything about that basic functions. Just like every year, we still do the preventive corrections, conservation, preventive correction, conservations. It's like we do the chemical treatments to the room of exhibitions. We washing the batiks. We fixing when there is something broken in the collection, just like that. We still do.
And how many staff are there?
20.
20.
And only for the civil servants. I mean that only for thinkers.
I see.
And two is on administration. So only two thinkers in this museum. One staff named Asror. He is the museology. He do about the basic functions. And I did the public programmer. Mm-hmm. Like that.
I see. And the rest are more of like supporting roles.
Yeah, supporting roles.
I see. And okay, so you outlined a few weaknesses and challenges. What would be like the priority that the museum need? Like, you know, urgently we need help or assistance in this.
Yes. What urgently?
Or what everything was.
yes, one of. The pandemic must be over first. Yes, must be. Pandemic really, really get us bored, yes. For this year, we don't have big plans. We only have the annual activities, just like what I have told you, with some improvements. Once we have the idea of creating contents about the museum, about everything here held by the museum. But I'm not a really technology person, and some stuff also like that. Yes, we have so many plans, but not work until now. The leader of the museum has asked, after the 8th holiday, you have to do that. Okay, yes. It's like that. We don't have a big plan for it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I guess to create content to manage or maintain awareness of the museum, I would guess.
Yeah.
Do you guys do anything online during the pandemic?
Yes, we just like by the competition, we go online, but learning with community, we do it offline in the museums. For each subject, we have about 6 subjects learning, and each subject only 30 people, 30 participants here. And yes, for the body competition, still online, I think. But in these years, we want to spread the competitions to some months. Okay. Last year's only in October. Everything's on October. So many people come in one time. It's not good. But now we want to do it in August, in September. Yeah, just like each month we have activities.
Yeah. And oh, sorry, you mentioned classes and modules. What classes are those?
The classes, the classes is about making batik paintings, making shibori, tie-dye,
I see.
Eco prints, and maybe this year we want to make a comic, just like that, comic or batik fashion design, like I guess. Still my idea. I hope we can make it, realize it.
Oh, cool, nice. Those are for like the textile techniques. You need to do it offline, I would guess. It's easier to do it offline. Yeah.
Yes, we do it offline. We do it offline. Only 30 participants. Mm-hmm. Like that. We have a big rooms here, so we can do social distancing. There's only 30%. We can put focus about the protocols.
Wait, are you teaching comics or you are making comics?
No. We ask the community. I have so many friends. One of my friends, can do everything about making comic cats. Why don't you and your community come to the museums? We can have accommodation for that.
Mm-hmm. As in, from outside of Pekalongan.
Outside, yes.
I see. How's the local visitorship? I mean, definitely the international are not coming in. But...
Yes, the locals in the early of 2020, very little. But in the end of 2020, the visitors grow out. There is visitors from neighbor city come here in a bus. Yes. But stop, you have to wear mascara. Yes, in the end of 2020, we grow the visitors.
Yeah. Oh, probably like just off the topic, outside of the museum, since you have been like in Pekalongan for a while, people often ask me, what's there in Pekalongan other than the batik, either batik museum or batik workshops? What else are there?
So actually in Pekalongan, in my opinion, besides batik, the special thing in the city is that this is the main city, very small city, but near the Pekalongan city, there are so many tourism objects just like that, and place for the interest like that. The landscapes very good in Pekalongan Regency, in Batang Regency, and the hotels. Cheers in Pekalongan. Pekalongan is the main city in the surrounding like that. Mm-hmm. And yes, here we have a beach here, but it is still under the developments because I hope it is good, because before it not really good.
Yeah. Well, hopefully when we are able to travel over, there is something else.
And the food here is very good.
Yes.
Food here is very good.
Oh, yeah. Okay. And yeah, finally, before we close off our conversation today, probably you mentioned a little bit of developing classes. What any other projects that you're working on?
Yes, actually, I have personal interest which I can do related with the museum, just like I want to create just like a space for photography showing you the people about the Pekalongan cultures, just like that. And I also have idea to create a book, not hard book, but it is like a comic or easy book about batik to students, just like that. Like that, but still in my idea, I have so many idea, but I don't know.
Yeah, it's just the resources to execute, right?
Yes, we really need other help in improving the museum, because we don't have so many staff here with good potentials. It's like that.
Yeah, definitely. I would be open to like work something with the museum, because I think it's a really important institution, especially in one of the heart of Batik Center, to have that representation an information source, education, and yeah, of course, leisure in general, right in the city of where batik is. So yeah, it's really pitiful if we have like all the different collections, but we are unable to take care and showcase it.
Yeah. Yes.
And final thoughts before we close off the conversation today.
Yes, my hope. God, please stop the pandemic. Yes, that's one of the main key to improve our life, and then we can be a new, mm-hmm. a new someone with a new gun, with a new bullet to improve our life. And yes, and we also have collaborations. We need so many help from you, from so many people to improve the museums.
Yeah.
Because we know we are very weak here in the museums, but yes, still, but we still have spirits to improve ourselves. Okay, like that.
Yeah, support from the communities and the enthusiasts who love batik, right?
Yes.
All right. Thank you so much again, Mas Dewa, for sharing and your time today.
Thank you, Tony. The opportunity is really great.
Yeah. Thank you for watching or listening to today's episode of Unrespective. If you like this, do check out our previous episodes with other guests over on our IGTV or on our website. And follow us on social media at UnnerGallery on Instagram or Facebook to find out more about our future happenings. And until next time, stay safe and take care.